Welcome to Advanced Spotter Training. In this video, we will dive into the complicated yet fascinating world of severe storm ingredients. It is our hope that after completing this training, you will have a greater understanding and respect of the complicated combination of ingredients that must exist for severe storms to develop and thrive. All right, before we begin, we need to go ahead and recall a few basic equations. First off, we'll need our set of variables, our equations of motion, different forecast equations, my favorite, the quasi-geostrophic omega equation, the basic equations of conservation of momentum, energy, mass, and water, not forgetting the equation of states, and finally we'll need the hypsometric equation to complete the derivation of the second law of thermodynamics. Okay, I know, right now you're thinking they're kidding, right? Well, we are. Or are we? Well, we're all in luck, because we're not going to go that in-depth in this training. In general, we can break down the ingredients of severe storms into four separate but easily understood components: moisture, instability, lift, and wind shear, with wind shear playing a vital role in the development of supercell thunderstorms. So let's start from the beginning. Nearly all moisture for thunderstorms across the plains is transported from the Gulf of Mexico. Commonly, southerly winds ahead of a strong storm system moving off the western high plains drives this transportation of moisture. To the west, behind a cold front and or dry line, which we'll describe later, very dry air is transported off the desert southwest. So how do we measure that available moisture? We use the dew point temperature. In short, the dew point temperature is the temperature at which water condenses. The higher the dew point, the more water vapor in the air. The dew point can never be more than the observed temperature, and if the temperature falls, the dew point will follow. When the temperature and dew point are equal, the air is completely saturated. Now that we've discussed moisture, let's discuss how it plays a major role in the development of instability. In short, instability is the term meteorologists use to describe the atmosphere's tendency to encourage or deter vertical motion. In the simplest sense, we need warm, moist air to rise for thunderstorms to develop. For instability to exist, we usually have warm, moist air in the lowest levels of the atmosphere, with generally cooler air aloft. When you think instability, one only needs to picture a hot air balloon, which uses instability to its advantage. The air within the balloon is much warmer than that of the surrounding air. Therefore, the warm air creates buoyancy. Now, working against buoyancy is gravity. When the buoyancy is greater than that of the downward force of gravity, the net gain is your instability. Now that we know what instability is, how do we measure it in the atmosphere? How do we quantify it? We use a measurement called CAPE, which stands for Convective Available Potential Energy. We measure CAPE by looking at the atmosphere in the vertical. One of the best ways of doing this is by releasing a weather balloon and actually sampling the atmosphere. The data that is returned by the weather balloon is plotted on a skew-T diagram, which we call a sounding. Here are two basic examples of a skew-T diagram. On the sounding, we theoretically lift a parcel of air either from the surface or from a desired height in the atmosphere, which is represented by the yellow line on the two soundings above. We then measure the area between the temperature, the red line, and the yellow line, the trajectory of the parcel. That area is the computed CAPE, which has units of joules per kilogram. The distribution of CAPE in the atmosphere plays a critical role in thunderstorm development. Both sounding A and sounding B have the same value of CAPE, but notice their distribution is very different. The fatter CAPE of sounding A may be more beneficial for development than the skinny CAPE of sounding B. So, now that we have discussed what instability is, let's go ahead and discuss the CAP and its role in the development and sometimes hindrance of thunderstorms. Given that this is advanced training, many, if not all of you, have likely heard one time or another about the CAP. Either the CAP is limiting thunderstorm development or the CAP is eroding and development has started. So what is the CAP? The CAP is basically a region in the atmosphere where air temperature increases with height instead of decreasing. The more technical term is temperature inversion. So let's say we have a parcel of warm air and it's rising through cooler air within the environment. So it's unstable. But then our parcel rises into an environment that is warmer than itself. Once the parcel reaches a level where its temperature equals that of the inversion, it stops rising. Our parcel has become stable. Here's a quick way to visualize the CAP in three dimensions. We have the surface with our dry line and region of warm, moisture-laden air advecting into the region, and above, at approximately 3,000 feet, we have our layer of warm or hot air. This is our CAP, or temperature inversion, if you will. For forecasters and spotters, the easiest way to observe the cap is to look at either an operational or model sounding. Here we have a model sounding from April of 2013. Notice the temperature begins to rise with height once you get to a height of approximately 3,000 to 4,000 feet. This is your cap. Sometimes you can actually visualize the temperature inversion with your own eyes. I would imagine many of you watching right now have seen smokestacks either from factories or power plants where the rising smoke, which is unstable, suddenly begins to flatten out and spread like it's hitting the ceiling. The region where the smoke begins to spread is the location of the cap, or temperature inversion. Okay, so we've discussed moisture, we've discussed instability, and we've covered the role and the impact of the cap. Now, thunderstorms can form with only the lift available from instability, when no capping inversion is present. We typically refer to these storms as pulse thunderstorms, but we'll dive more into thunderstorm types in another video. For the moment, let's focus on what many consider the most severe type of thunderstorm, the supercell. Now, from the previous slides, you might be thinking, well, the cap is bad, but au contraire. The cap plus instability play a vital role in the development of strong, severe thunderstorms, typically supercellular thunderstorms. With that said, with a cap in place early in the day into the early afternoon, you can build up cape at the surface and even above the cap. This is especially true on days when there is a fairly stout inversion. Now, this is where lift comes into play. We need a source of lift to give a nudge upward to help our parcel of air bust through the cap and rise into the unstable air above it. Lift comes in many forms, the most common being that of warm and cold fronts, dry lines, and outflow from current or previous thunderstorms. Let us now focus on the outflow scenario. Thunderstorm development due to outflow is a particularly fascinating way of generating lift. This is because for outflow boundaries to be present, there must already be thunderstorms or the remnants of thunderstorms in the general area. Take the example shown. We have a line of thunderstorms shown on radar. Extending out from the storm is a visual boundary picked up on the base reflectivity scan. The storm farthest to the left likely developed along the outflow boundary, which was generated by the storm to its right. Another example would be that of morning boundaries left by mesoscale convective systems, or MCSs. In short, MCSs are just a large cluster of thunderstorms that usually develop late in the evening and persist through the morning hours. But as mentioned before, we'll go more into thunderstorm types in another video. However, sometimes the boundaries left by MCSs can linger through the afternoon, providing a source of lift for afternoon thunderstorms. Okay, now that I've bored you with all this talk about lift, instability, the cap, and what was it? Oh yeah, moisture. Let's get into some serious fluid dynamics. Recall those equations? Right then, only kidding. But seriously, let's talk about wind shear. One of the most vital components in the development of severe thunderstorms. In the simplest terms, wind shear is generated by increasing wind speed and or direction with height. We need deep, strong wind shear for the development of supercells. Wind shear is measured in knots, and we usually look for deep wind shear within a layer from the surface to about 6 kilometers above the ground. Now for the development of tornadoes, we need strong low-level wind shear. And for this, we usually look at the surface to about 1 to 3 kilometers. Here's a simple example of how wind shear results in the development of rotation within thunderstorms. First off, you have very strong winds aloft. Notice the high clouds are tilted in the direction of the upper level flow. Meanwhile, the winds near the surface are slower. The difference between these two wind speeds, the shear, and since we're only dealing with changes in speed with height, we'd call this speed shear. This results in a rotational component. This rotation is vital for the development of severe supercellular thunderstorms. Okay, so let's take this a step further. What if we add a directional component to our shear profile? So we not only have winds increasing in speed with height, we also have a change in direction. Here our surface winds start out from the southeast, and as we move up in the atmosphere, our winds veer, or turn clockwise, with height. So as the previous example, we still have a rotational component in the horizontal. Now if we add an updraft, we begin to tilt this rotation into the vertical. This is a critical component to the development of supercellular thunderstorms. Alright, so now we have our established rotating updraft. Recall from basic spotter training that a supercell is defined as having a persistent, deep, rotating updraft, which we call the mesocyclone. In tornadic supercells, the mesocyclone is the source of rotation for the tornado. Remember, all supercells have a mesocyclone, but not all supercells result in a tornado. In fact, there are thousands of supercellular storms every year across the world, but only a fraction of these generate a tornado. Now I know there's a lot going on in this image, and we'll dive into the nuts and bolts of supercells in another video. But for right now, the major takeaway from this video is to understand and respect all the intricate ingredients that have to combine for supercells and severe storms to develop. In closing, I just want to remind all of you that safety is your number one priority. Don't risk your life for a video, photograph, or report. Always report what you see, and don't ever assume it's already been reported. Make sure you stay in touch. Follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook, and definitely subscribe to our YouTube channel. We will continue to post more videos diving into advanced spotter topics as the months move on. We have a lot of topics to cover, such as storm types and structure, safe spotting practices, and where to find and how to monitor data. The topics are endless. Finally, thank you for your interest in advanced spotter training. Let us know what you think of this video in the comments section below. Spotters are our eyes in the field, and we appreciate all you do. And with that, this concludes the Severe Storms Ingredients Advanced Spotter Training video from the National Weather Service Norman, Oklahoma Forecast Office. Thank you.